My real interest in life is football, so, but I didn't want to bother you with that today, so we'll be on politics for a while. But I'm often asked, what are my interests these days? Well, I have three interests. I'm trying to save the Labour Party, I'm trying to save Scottish football, and of course, I'm trying to keep Britain in the European Union. So it seems to me three laudable objectives. Only one of them, I think, is achievable. I'll leave you to ponder later on. It might be obvious from my comments that I'm going to have. First of all, thanks very much for coming. What I'd like to try and do is to, maybe for the next 15, 20 minutes, is to be rather discussive at one kind of start and one of the middle at one of an end, but to reflect on the reasons behind writing the book Citizens United. As you know, this is a bit of a mocking of America, the title, because in 2010, I think, the Supreme Court took a decision, and it was called Citizens United. And this was an attempt to put a coach of horses through any constraints on the financing of elections in America. Now, American financing of elections is nearly corrupt. I say nearly because I'm not a lawyer, I don't understand the technicalities, but the money that pours into American elections is very formidable. And it leads to a position, unlike Lincoln's comment, of the people, by the people, for the people. It really is off the pharmaceuticals, by the pharmaceuticals, for the pharmaceuticals. I mean, that's the tenor of it. And this really stupid decision was taken by the Supreme Court, which opened the floodgates to entities being given legal status in America. And so therefore, they could act like individuals in the democratic process. So I thought, just for a bit of novelty, I would call it Citizens United, because my main task today is to talk about not a coach of horses through the financing of political expenditure, but about the role of the citizen in the political process. And my thesis is simply this, that I've had 30 years in elected office, 15 years in non-elected office in a way, and I'm still involved heavily in public service, so that's 45 years, you know, in the Labour Party for nearly 50 years. And at this point, you're supposed to go to your colleague and say, doesn't look that way. Very few people did that, so that's a bit unnerving. But anyway, with all that behind me, maybe no more so than others, it just seems important to try and reflect on what all of that has meant, looking back, but more importantly, to cast some views on the current state of affairs. My thesis is this, that our governance, our politics, and our democracy are a train wreck in Britain today. Now, sadly, in my view, it's not just in Britain, but it's in Western democracies. It's in the United States, where a unique phenomenon called Trump genuinely trumps everybody in relation to the decline in progressiveness in terms of the idea of the common good. But I thought, with democracy, governance, and politics, that would give me a hook to hang some of my concerns about where we actually are. If I'm to think about citizens, you know, we can think back to the Roman, the Greeks, you know, where they had little representative groups, 500 of them, you know, no women, no slave, no aliens, but everybody had a chance to put their hand up, decide on things. Very early form of representative democracy, or direct democracy, and of course that disappeared when the Greeks went into different times. You could talk then, coming up today, but Lincoln, you know, made the reference of the people, by the people, for the people, Gettysburg Address. Some suggestion that citizens have a very special place in all of this. But coming back to today then, what is the role of the citizen, other than voting every year now virtually with referenda and other elections? But are they subject to the requirements of two elections? That's what the ordinary citizen think really matter? Should they have a influence in what we do? And then I thought about this analogy. You know, in a capitalist system or in a market system, we get ratings for being good consumers. We have credit scores and credit ratings. And that helps you when you go to Boston. And it keeps your status in society. Then I thought to myself in a very simplistic way, there are no prizes for being citizens. It's about passports. It's about who you are. It's about signing forms. But in a sense, how seriously do we take citizens? My contention is not very seriously at all. So that was really my starting point. Now, in terms of democracy, a lot of people believe that by having the vote, that's essentially satisfied democracy. But it isn't, because it's about the rule of law, it's about freedoms, it's about a whole range of things, including the freedom of expressions. And for me, I think that the democracy we have just now is still weighted towards those who can influence, whether it be elites in parliament, whether it be the media, or whether it be industry and the powers that be there. And I just feel for the citizens an uphill struggle to try and get their views heard, listened to, acted upon in government. And in that sense, people are always surprised when I say, well, look, you have a democracy where people vote. You know, do you think that was given as some kind of benevolent piece of inspiration from the top? No, it was hard fought. I mean, in America, the Madisons of the world, the founding fathers, they were very concerned about giving the vote to the mob, as it was construed. The same with the aristocrats in the British Parliament. I feel a surprise to know that only in, I think, in 1968, under the Jim Callaghan government, did women at 18 eventually get the vote. Now, ladies and gentlemen, that's only 50 years ago. As I said, it wasn't handed down with great generosity. It was grudgingly pulled out of aristocracy in America and in the United Kingdom. So it was really just a point to say that we take for granted that this democracy has been there for a long time, has served us well, and it will continue to serve us well. I'm not convinced it will in its present form unless changes take place. In terms of governments, the other big word. My concern about Scotland, for example, just now, is not that Scotland is shy of an argument about independence. But I'm actually more concerned about the way Britain's governed and the implications for Scotland. I believe Britain's been badly governed. That's a product of history. And it's also a product still, despite devolution, of one of the most centralised countries in Western Europe. So when we talk about governance, it's easy to talk about government and we elect them and we let them get on with it. But Lord Hailsham, some considerable time ago, used the phrase elective or elected dictatorship. We have a position just now in Britain. We have 11, 13 DUP members who are not sufficiently organised to get their own assembly back in view. They're propping up a Conservative government with no majority. But then, within that setup, you have the government. Within the government, you have the cabinet. Within the cabinet, you have the Prime Minister in number 10 Downing Street. So, who does run Britain? Is it you and I? I don't think so. What is the worth of a Scottish vote? And even more, what is the worth of an Irish vote in Northern Ireland? Where the outcome is a propping up of the party with least votes in Northern Ireland to the party in the United Kingdom. So it's these small things start to engage my brain and think, well, are we being sensibly run? And my answer is not. There are many, many more examples. And underlining all of that is the crucial thing for me, which is highly political, is that it's the unequal distribution in Britain. Power, wealth, money, and opportunity. Because I meet a lot of people in my old constituency. I was in America for 2 months teaching, speaking to a lot of Americans. And there was an interesting discussion in America by CNN, visiting one of the left-behind states. And so they interviewed some Trump people, some Trump voters. Well, this is about 5 months ago. Are you still supporting President Trump? Of course we are. He's a first-class leader. He says everything that we think, and we're glad we supported him. And then he said, well, isn't he a bit of a reprobate? Isn't he a bit of this, that? Isn't he a bad person? Of course he is. The answer was. So the CNN reporter said, what do you mean? You mean you hate him as a person, but love him as a leader?
Yes.
You know what the message of that? That 40% of Americans, his base, still absolutely loyal. And one of the reasons why, very simplistic reason, is that he is a showman, business leader, deal maker, so-called. He talks to them, in my view, in a passionizing way, but in a way they understand. He shares their every prejudice. He shares their every aspiration. And of course, he's the only person who can deliver any of it to anyone. But still, he's sick to what he's doing. Now, ladies and gentlemen, that seems to me, this is less about Trump and more about us. Across the parties, Democrats, Socialists, Progressives, Liberals, in a good mood, even Conservatives. So, in that sense, what is the issue there? And this comes back to this question for me about governance. We, I think, as Progressives, I have certainly learned a lot, but I was part of taking for granted democracy, taking for granted that everybody would always vote Labour in Scotland in this sense of entitlement. That's got to be shaken up. And then finally, itself on democracy, governance and politics. I've come to believe now that the way we organise political in Britain is quite primitive, even relative to some of the countries in Western Europe. Our politics is about extremes. Scotland's future in the UK, in or out, binary question to a fantastically complicated issue. European Union, in or out, binary question to an even more complicated set of circumstances. Is this really what politics in the 21st century should be about? That we cannot get to a point where, despite my views about equality, the common good, socialist, why can't I speak to other people? Why can't we take the base of our activity, the problems we're trying to deal with, and the games that we get involved with? And I think that's very powerful. Now, to be fair, I was part of the tribalism at Westminster. After having played football, you wouldn't believe what we say in the House of Commons. It's all edited out, but it's very tribal. And there's no coming together of minds. Sometimes it's a set play where we play games. Other times it's deadly scenes. But we're dominated in Scotland and in Britain by the politics of extremes. It's a kind of with us against us. Now, in my view, if you even look at Western Europe, let's look at the much maligned Germany. What about the idea of consensus, coalition, cooperation? The mere fact that there are issues facing the public in Scotland and facing the public in Britain that don't need extreme solutions, but he needs solutions which tackles the problems of the people we're representing, relates to the resources we have available. And of course, I would then have to come back and say, well, look, I can't get on my own way. But politics in Britain is now, I have to get it all my own way or nothing. I'm not sure that's right. The tribalism, the partisanship may have served a purpose, but I'm not conscious of when that was. I'm not conscious looking back where we did that. So I would like to think that in terms of our politics, it leads us on to issues about having the first past the post system start is destroying America. I mean, America genuinely won its 2 parties. How can you take 220 million Americans and divide them into 2 parties, and then within each party there is a wide, wide range of opinions? And despite the fact you have about 20 parties in Britain, Labour and the Conservatives still dominate Westminster. Of course, not in Scotland, but it focuses Westminster at the present time. So why can't we have a first-past-the-post system scrapped? Why is Westminster the only part of Britain, the only part of our democracy that still has first-past-the-post? What is special to Westminster that allows assemblies in Ireland and Wales to vote differently? And in Scotland, I'll tell you what it is. It's the absolute sovereignty in the thinking of Westminster that we can do whatever we want within reason, but it won't change them. I spent 14 years in the place. It was a great privilege. Sometimes you did feel that you were walking 6 inches above the ground, especially in the tea rooms and the farms in the evening. But it's a very exceptional place. And so the first question for me is, Westminster, what's the deal here? And there's no deal. It's history, it's delusional in a way, and that's where we are. If you then take the House of Lords, and I have to say with some hypocrisy that they're doing a great job just now, with the Brexit withdrawal bill. On the other hand, I'd love to see the back of them. For no other reason than I don't want to be represented, because it's a second house. It does have an impact on legislation, but I didn't elect any of them. In the history, for example, of the Senate in the United States was, only in the last 30, 40 years, maybe 50 years, did they decide to make the Senate elected. The Founding Fathers created 2 chambers, but one of them wasn't elected. neither of them was elected at the time, but then the House of Representatives became elected. But the same situation emerged that they didn't want it elected. So the idea of changing at Westminster is really very, very difficult. I'm a Federalist at heart.
So sorry.
I was going to say the focus is on you, but basically, my fault. They know that. But anyway, in terms of federalism, I'm sympathetic to the idea of independence. I made that quite clear. I'm also sympathetic to the fact that there's a better way of governing Britain, and that could be federalism. Now, what are the prospects of a federalist debate in Britain, a vote for federalism, and a change within the next 2,000 years? No, it's not going to happen. So again, we come back to this idea that in terms of politics, we have a great deal of issues to deal with, but it's looking to a wider horizon. I think I've broken out of now the captured frame of Westminster, the idea that because I think that I have to do this and it's the expense of the world. That to me, ladies and gentlemen, is an issue that we have to leave behind. So very briefly, let's talk how that kind of stuff impacts on where we are. Populism is a much discussed phrase. Now, despite the colour of my hair, I was born post-war. But before the war, in 1914-1939, we had some form of populism. I don't want to dramatise or exaggerate, but fascism is a form of populism, as it was exercised in Germany and Italy. Now, I'm not thinking for a minute that the current debate reflects that. But let's for a minute look at some of the ingredients, though, in Western Europe and in Trumpsville in America. Because basically, it's not the same guys coming by, but if you look at it closely, it is about economic nationalism. Look at Hungary, look at Poland. Austria's got a right-wing government, although it still likes the European Union. Italy hasn't got any government, but they're well used to that. And it's pretty crazy what's happening there. If you look at Germany with the alt-right, if you look at France, Macron's victory. A lot of parties may not look what they are, but they speak the language, first of all, of economic nationalism, secondly, authoritarianism. And in Hungary, for example, deal with the media, deal with the courts, deal with the discourse. And all of a sudden, people who thought they were there are actually here, but they haven't recognized them because they don't bump into the media or the courts or the legal system every day. Then you've got a situation where we've got, apart from authoritarianism, nationalism, you've got isolationism. This is make America great again. And we've heard it in Westminster. Let's make Britain great again. That simple slogan simply means, in my view, English votes for British laws. It's the hangover from Brexit. And then we've got nativism. Then we've got xenophobia. Then we've got Islamic issues. And all of a sudden, you look at this bowl of ingredients, and you realise, I didn't come into politics to share any of that. But that's on the ascendancy. In my opinion, are on the decline. So what is the issue? And then what is more poisonous than any of that is the issue of immigration, and the idea of colour, and the idea of difference. Post-Brexit, and through Brexit, it was littered with poisonous activities on the different people. Because a great part of populism is to have all of these qualities I've described, but also to find an enemy. 1939, 4, there was the Jews. Today, in maybe a more comfortable setting, it's colour. As far as some are concerned, it's about European enemies. It's about Muslims. It's about difference. And so therefore, you've got the situation where a group of factors identify populism, but they need also to go one step further and create a common enemy that we all dislike so that we can motivate, galvanize, bring solidarity into the cause. That is one consequence of the type of politics that we have. The second item is Brexit itself. I mean, no apologies for saying that it's, in my judgment, the most monumentally stupid decision Britain's taken since Suez, and maybe Farage. Because I don't want to offend anybody here who's in that camp, but I haven't met a Brexiteer yet who can tell me what the benefit is. For most Brexiteers, the benefit is leaving the EU. There are no subsequent benefits to follow. And I hear this idea that we want to leave a European Union, European Colonial Seal in 52, Treaty of Rome in 58, and since that point, within the boundaries of the American evolving Europe, peace, security, stability, prosperity, and in some respects, a bit of solidarity. Are we really willing to sacrifice all of that and walk into a world with Erdogan in Turkey, Trump in America, Duarte in the Philippines, Netanyahu in Israel, Putin in Russia, President Xi in China? That's the world that we are now trying to hawk around to build this great trading empire. And much of that smacks of the delusion that, you know, it's still choppy seas out there, but Britain still wants to rule the waves. There are those amongst us. Not here. This was part of the motivation for a lot of people, Labour voters, northeast of England, who looked ahead after 2008 with not much future, look at the present with no increase for 10 years, and what happens if you don't have a future or a present? You look backwards. A delusion, sentiment, nostalgia, all come together. And then when you have the kinds of Gove, Johnson, et al, and Rees-Mogg. I don't know if, maybe you're too illustrious to read the Sunday Mail, but it's one of God's papers. But anyway, there's an article last week about Rees-Mogg. And funnily enough, he came to cut the political teeth in my constituency in 1997. We thumped him, I mean, we just massively won. But that was expected. This was his first time out. He didn't look like an MP then, never mind a future Prime Minister. And can you imagine the Rees-Mogg, 20 years younger, but with the same clothes? Difficult. But anyway, he was okay then, because I protected him. I was taking him to some of the wildest political areas on this planet, like Methil. My hometown. He was sitting on this podium, and I was just fearful for his life. So I protected him. But anyway, the conclusion of the story was that after been done and he had cut his teeth. His father was the illustrious editor of the Times, William Rees-Mogg, and he sent me a lovely letter basically saying, look, Mr. McCluch, I don't normally write to Labour MPs in this way, but I'd like to thank you for looking after my son and his first political foray. It was a very touching letter, respected it and replied to it, but on the other hand, if I knew then, now I wouldn't have been so particularly sympathetic. But coming back to Brexit, this is the kind of situation. Now, when you think of that relative to democracy, relative to government, relative to politics, you have to conclude that it's something fundamentally at odds with the people and the product. And this is not an insult to those who voted Leave, but if you can see that referenda, as a tool that the American government doesn't use at federal level, and a lot of other countries don't, but we use it now, not as a constitutional measure of success, but as a convenience. And it's convenience of the Conservative Party in a way to take the poison that's been filtering through their party for the last 20 years and actually bring it to the fore in terms of the British people being asked to solve it. So in that sense, Brexit is a problem. Now thirdly, just I want to finish on this one to give an indication of it. I said earlier that I am open to Scotland's future because I do believe that we've been badly governed by Britain. I believe in devolution 20 years ago, this year when the legislation was passed, and 20 years ago when the Parliament started, was a big improvement. But the Scottish Parliament doesn't have many powers. And when I say powers, there's powers over education, powers over health. But as we've seen from the Brexit process, it is no political or constitutional power whatsoever. Because the power devolved is not power shared. We don't have a federal system where we have two authorities that don't have supreme authority over each other. So I'm open to suggestions, but what I'd like to see in Scotland is that we lift our horizons. I don't want the next referendum to be about independence. I would rather it be about the future of Scotland. What's your Scotland to look like? Do we want to be an offshore kind of basket case, tax haven, low welfare, low tax, America type entity? As some of the zealots down south would want us to have? Or is there another future that we can't take an ideal like Norway, Sweden, Denmark, Finland, Iceland, we can't transfer a whole model, but are there parts of what they do that appeal to us and appeal to me? Yes, there are. So in our democracy that we've got, we manage to exclude quickly, and all of a sudden, the flavour of the day, or the flavour of the month, flavour of the year, flavour of the decade, is independence. And it's obvious from the independence debate that there are not enough Scots in love with that idea that they would go willingly to an early poll and vote yes for it. But that doesn't mean to say that independence may not happen. All my plea is in the current politics is to say, let's have a bigger debate and let's ask some of the real questions that that should tax us, rather than some of the concentration on one party that's done amazingly well to corner the argument, leave an elephant in the room to which the Tories, Labour and the Liberals have really at this stage no alternative to bid. So with all of these things in mind, I just believe that in Scotland we deserve a bigger debate. We deserve political parties, our members, our representative members, to start discussing things freed from the shackles of saying anything is going to get you into trouble with the Whips, or get you into trouble with the party. Because Scotland at this time, as a centre of discussion about devolution, about the future of Parliament, about Brexit, we should be leading Europe in terms of that debate, but we're not. Because there's a bit of exceptionalism about Scotland. We could learn from other countries, not just the Scandinavians, but we don't. We could take action that makes us look more like them than England, but we don't. And there's some kind of blend in our background which means, oh, you invented devolution. Fine. We don't need to embellish that too much by more original thinking. So that's why I mentioned Citizens United covers all of these particular subjects. And I'll finish with this comment that, as far as I'm concerned, I would describe myself, I suppose, as a socialist, and I've always been, I've been a member of the Labour Party now for since 1970. That's nearly 15 years. People say to me at times, why are you still in the Labour Party? And I say to them that the principles that fired the party in 1900 are the same principles that my grandmother and grandfather, who were minor socialist evangelical Christians, voted for and so on. But on the other hand, I'm now at a point where it doesn't mean to say that I have to push that down the throats of everyone else. And politicians should listen at times more than we speak, and if we did, that if a better debate in Scotland would come up with some of the more creative ideas. And hey, they may take 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years. Some of us may not see that, some may do. But the benefit would be a Scotland that not only was thinking in terms of its status as a country, but also as a status as a people, who could think ahead. And let's remember the Enlightenment that took place between 1710 and 1840. As Voltaire said, this is the place to be if you want to think. You need to get back to that. Thanks very much.